like a whole a whole psychology study, like all virtual. I think that I rather know like where I'm going to live. Then I decide like what to study and where. Yes. Because if okay. I'm in Redfield, maybe I can even study there. So.
Okay, but. We're going to get into week four of Music for Our Spiritist Soul, and I am recording. And today's topic I have titled Rhythmic Vibrations. So today we're going to take what I've done in the previous weeks and add some spice. So just quickly to summarize the prior weeks, we talked about in week one, what is music? We talked about a variety of different things, but we come to this very simple statement of it's pleasing tones and sounds in combination. And a key emphasis there on pleasing, because it has to be pleasing to us for us to consider it music. Even if we're told it's music, if we don't enjoy it, it's not the music we're going to think of. In week two, we got more into vibrations. We realized that they are unique to each human. Each human responds differently to vibrations. And it triggers emotions from sadness to joy to everything else and in between. The different tones or pitch of music each have unique vibrations, measurable vibrations. And so does the earth. So there's a whole scientific aspect to vibrations. We also talked in week three about spirits being affected by vibrations, often because they are in attunement with the humans who are emitting or causing the vibrations. To the spirits, human music has little impact, although lower spirits can affiliate with lower vibrations, including lower vibration forms of music. On the other end of the spectrum, meditation, often done with music, can result in very positive spiritual vibrations. So that's a quick summary of where we've been. And through all that, I've given you a broad range of recordings and even a little bit of live music to try to enhance and support some of the information I've been communicating. And today will be no different.
Mark, are we doing the opening prayer?
Oh, thank you, Kiki. Before I get into rhythm, yes, please. Do I have a volunteer? Okay, Kiki, you're up.
All right. So let us all close our eyes and take a deep breath, serening our heart and our mind, and connecting our thoughts to our mentors, to the mentors of this group, giving thanks to Jesus for the blessed opportunity that we have to be here gathered in this beautiful place, in this virtual place, where we can discuss and understand more about this beautiful form of art, which is music. So thank you so much for all the mentors, teachers, and for Mark for being here for us and with us. May all of us be vibrating in the same level, exchanging love and beauty within this group. May this gathering be blessed, and we open the study for this day. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiki. And thank you for catching that I'd gone right through it. The previous prayer session, I thought we were already rolling. So, I want to begin talking about rhythmic vibrations from the perspective of the Earth's history or humankind's history. So, rhythm and the vibrations of rhythm have been around since the beginning of mankind. And the only reason I say from that point is because it's mankind who has the concept of creating rhythms and hearing them. Certainly before mankind, if there were animals on the planet, they were creating rhythmic vibrations, but we humans didn't know about it at all and didn't categorize it as such. So I picked this point in time that says the history of mankind. So the first example of rhythmic vibrations in mankind occurred because of the need or desire to communicate. Perhaps it was an early caveman who was frustrated or angry at not being able to kill dinner. And so he pounded on the ground, or he pounded on a rock, or pounded with a rock to express his frustrations. Probably grunted as well. Perhaps in the middle of a hunt, he pounded a rock on a log or on another rock and realized there were different sounds. Pounding the ground, pounding a log, pounding a rock. Three different distinct sounds. And you can just imagine that if there were other cavemen all on the hunt at the same time, but physically separated, when one pounded, perhaps another one responded. And communication began. In fact, psychologists will say this was the first example of nonverbal communication. Communication over a distance with these types of sounds. Now, through the millennia, and certainly in the centuries since Jesus walked the earth, those simple communications of sounds and their vibrations have evolved in a variety of different ways. So I want to play a clip from a rock and roll band, and that's because that's what they're called. I think they're much more than that. The group is called the Moody Blues, and they originated in England in the 60s and became very popular in the 70s and have continued to this very day. But I want you to hear this one.
Mark, I don't know if it's playing. If does anyone can hear it?
You're not hearing.
No, we can't hear it.
Yeah.
are you not hearing?
No. Did you share sound when you were sharing screen?
I thought so. It's okay. I'm going to stop and try this again. Because there's an important concept that I want to communicate. Let's try it again. I'm screen sharing, recording to the cloud. New share. Let's try a new share. But I don't have the ability to control the sound.
Do you want to stop sharing and then share it again?
Let's try this.
Oh. Yeah, now we can hear it. Yep.
Okay.
Communication.
I could listen to that forever, but that was literally the history of music in one song. Here's what you heard: the dawn of mankind, animal skin stretched to create a drum head, grunts and sound and tones in rhythms to drums, which were the first musical combinations. Then we evolved into syncopated grunts and tones called Gregorian chant, religious everywhere in the 9th and 10th centuries. This is the first music of the organized churches, were Gregorian chants. Then we had Middle Eastern music. You heard a sitar and percussion and flute from the 12th century. Then you heard from medieval Europe, lyres and lutes, as though from the royalty in the 12th and 15th centuries. Then you heard a harpsichord built by Italians for all kinds of European royalty in the 16th century. Then you heard a Bach organ fugue from the 17th and 18th centuries. Then you heard a full orchestra. And then you heard electronics and rock and roll. Literally, the history of music by one rock and roll band in one song. Pretty cool. Now, what's even better to a musician, that's pretty unique. But the album that they did this on is called Every Good Boy Deserves Favor. And that's a very famous phrase, because the first letter of each of those words, E, G, B, D, F, those are the five lines of a musical staff. Those are the names of the notes. Every good boy deserves favor. And so I learned at a very young age how to read music just by remembering E, G, B, D, F, on the black lines. And the open spaces spell the word face, F-A-C-E. So we'll get into that in a future week. Okay, so I want to introduce you all to the basics of drumming. Now, I'm going to preface what I'm about to teach you with the fact that I am a wannabe drummer. I have always been a wannabe drummer. I have always wanted to be a drummer. I got the opportunity a couple times to prove to people I should not be a drummer. But it's still one of the most enjoyable things I've ever done. And I'm going to take you through the basics of drumming now, beginning with a definition. So drumming is the ability to make a sound by some item striking a surface. And the more items and the more surfaces, the better. So most people will understand drumsticks. And there's a way to hold drumsticks to, depending on what it is you're drumming on, you're going to see that in just a second. And of course, you can drum on any number of things, from my desk to my computer, to this cup, to this bottle. I can drum on anything. And frustrated wannabe drummers will drum on just about everything. There are many of me in the world. And you know, if you've ever seen somebody tapping their fingers on a desktop, as though they're waiting patiently or impatiently, as the case may be, that's a form of drumming. And it's simply to say that there's more to drumming than tapping your feet to the rhythm. Now, there's another term I want to introduce you to, and it's called percussion or percussionists. So percussionists are drummers with a creative side. And that's my definition, because they will use anything and everything to play all kinds of sounds and rhythms to create all kinds of special effects. I'm going to give you a taste of that today as well. Now, the most important thing to understand about a drummer is they're there to have fun. No. The most serious drummers can still have fun being a serious drummer because they know exactly how to do that. The act of drumming is a very fun thing to do, no matter what you sound like. So I like to say that this class of humans that consider themselves drummers or percussionists, they got the beat. Inside of them, they have a metronome. Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock, tick tock. This is the rhythm that sits them up every morning. Out of bed, they get up to this rhythm. And sometimes they start going much faster, getting up to this rhythm. And sometimes they go in three patterns. One, two, three, one, two, three, instead of one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. Drummers march to their own beats every minute of every day. So as I said, they'll play more than one drum and use more than one set of sticks. So let me give you a taste of some well-known professional drummers. This goes on for quite some time. I'm just going to advance and let you hear. Let me back up just a second. Listen. What he does with cymbals are astounding. That is a master of a drum kit named Buddy Rich. And he made his reputation by being the drummer of some outstanding big bands from the 40s and 50s, and then launched his own band and took off on a whole different side of music, featuring himself, because he's world renowned as one of the best ever. Now, you move into the world of rock and roll, which is when drumming really became popular, and there's some very famous drum solos. again, that song and that drum solo is famous all by itself. That band never did another album. They only did one album. And that song was one entire side of the album. It's 28 minutes long. And it's got this bizarre name, Inagata De Vida. But as a rock and roll fan, I can tell you it's the all-time classic. I mean, you hear the opening guitar riff, you hear the opening drum riff, you hear the opening organ riff, and everybody knows that's Inagata De Vida. You know, if you've heard it once, you'll never forget. There's one more, and this is a particular favorite of mine. So I'm a child of the 60s. And in 1969, there was this little rock concert in upstate New York called Woodstock, where 500,000 people got together for 3 days. And on the first full day, as the rain started to come in, Santana was doing their second ever public appearance. They had just come from San Francisco and played a concert in Golden Gate Park. And they got on a plane and they flew to New York and they played their second ever live concert to 500,000 people. And the last song they did was this song of theirs on their first album called Soul Sacrifice. Now, the amazing thing about the story, the kid playing drums in this, he's 17 years old. Carlos Santana entrusted his band to a 17-year-old drummer. I want you to hear what this kid was able to do on stage.
We got one more tune for you. It's called Soul Sacrifice.
So this begins with the percussion section and then evolves into the drum solo. I could listen to that entire cut and have since 1971 repeatedly. So professional drummers, and you just saw three different flavors of professional drummers. You know, they're in an elite status is what I would say. And having tried to sit down at a drum kit and do something like that is rather humorous. It's, you know, it's living in fantasy land. Now, in prior weeks, I've introduced you to some of the instruments of the orchestra, and I've neglected to talk about the percussion section of the orchestra. So I want to touch that today. Regina had a specific interest in timpanis. So Regina, here is a timpani player on steroids. So notice the sticks. These are called mallets because there's something on the end of the sticks that's actually striking the surface of the drum head. Notice also you have five different drums, four are being played, and they all produce different sounds. Timpanis are the only drum instrument that can actually be tuned and can change pitch in the middle of the song. They all have foot levers that will change the pitch and tighten the skin to create a higher or loosen the skin to create a lower sound. So they are tuned. And again, we are back to that, what we learned in prior weeks about A equals 440. Now you're tuning the timpani to the same tuning standard that your entire orchestra is tuned to. Okay, now, focusing on the sticks, I want to introduce some other instruments that are also played with mallets. And the first one is called marimbas.
Hello, my name is Nathan Siegel.
Yes, University. It is.
Today, I'd like to talk to you about the marimba. The marimba is like a really big piano you play standing up, but instead of using your fingers, you use these mallets. You can make all kinds of sounds on the marimba. You can make loud, quick sounds. And you can make soft, sweet sounds.
So those are marimbas. Now, another instrument called vibes. V-I-B-E-S.
Okay, I'm back with the vibes with a video to show you how they work. Yeah. Okay, so anyway, that's pretty cool, huh?
So immediately you notice a completely different sound. Similar in structure, it's like a piano, but the instrument itself is producing a very different sound, A, because of the mallets, and B, because of the type of metal used for a vibe. Now, there's something else about vibes, and this is important to understand because we're talking about vibrations. All of these mallet instruments include what is called sustain capabilities, S-U-S-T-A-I-N. And what that means is, most drumming sounds is an immediate sound. That's it. But on some instruments, you can actually have the sound continue. Like singing a song. Notice how the word song was just extended. Well, vibes are used to extend the vibration. And I'm going to play something for you in a little bit that'll give you more of a sense of how those extended or sustained vibrations can create some beautiful, beautiful harmonies. Here's another one that people are very familiar with typically. This is called the xylophone. And the xylophone is cool because they're very inexpensive and a lot of children get them in elementary schools and learn how to play a xylophone. Now, percussion people love to do things in combination. I'm going to show you now a series of videos that are combinations. And the first one is a little bit formal. This is an actual symphonic piece, but pay attention to the ensemble itself. Pretty amazing stuff that can be done. And you know, in week one or week two, I talked a little bit about Beethoven, and I talked about a little bit about the effort to write music. So it's one thing to write a song for guitar and voice. It's something else to write a piano concerto. It's something else, again, to write for this many different mallet instruments of a pure percussion nature. There's no lead instrument. There's no violin. There was a piano there, but it didn't play lead. The mallets are playing the lead in these syncopated rhythms. So again, it's a whole different technique of music and composition of music. So again, expanding your knowledge, let's define this word rhythm. And it gets pretty sophisticated here. An ordered, recurring alternation of strong and weak elements in the flow of sound and silence in speech. Or the aspect of music comprising all the elements that relate to forward movement. Or movement, fluctuation, or variation marked by the regular recurrence or natural flow of related elements. Holy mackerel, that's a ton of stuff. What's rhythm? Rhythm is the beat. If you put your hand on your heart, you're going to feel the rhythm of your own heartbeat. Or on your pulse, on your wrist, you're going to feel the rhythm of your own body. But there are plenty of other rhythms for you to think about. So consider this, the paradox that is time. How many seconds are in a minute? 60. If you tap your finger to a surface 60 times in a minute, you have established a rhythm or a tempo. If you tap once every 5 seconds or 12 times a minute, you have established a different tempo. Now, literally, written music has, in the composer's mind, a defined meter or pace or tempo, call it what you want. But they will all often, you will see it labeled as a quarter note equals a number. Could be 80, could be 132. And what they're saying is number of beats per minute. 80 beats per minute is a moderate beat pattern. 132 is very fast. 32 is very slow. So all the music you enjoy, whatever your personal flavor of music that you enjoy, everything has a tempo. And oftentimes, what appeals to you is cultural in nature. It's the music you were raised with. It's the music you were sung to as a baby. It's the music you were exposed to during your formative years, or it's the music you learned to develop a passion for. But often it is cultural. It could be American blues or slow jazz. It could be a lively Latin or salsa beat. It could be a Middle Eastern or Asian melodic flow. It could be African in nature. So the rhythms are all different. Tempo is important because it establishes the basics for all the music that follows. So some spiritual evidence. We are now inhabited by incarnated spirits who have an obvious prior life capability. And it has been carried forward into this lifetime. So some children were born with an ability. There's many examples of young children who can play musical instruments in a manner that otherwise would take decades to become that proficient, that kind of produce, that kind of exemplary result. Medical science has analyzed these kids, these wonder kids, these gifted students for decades, trying to figure out what is it they've got? What's the unique combination of elements in their brain, in their body chemistry, in their upbringing, in their heritage, in whatever. Let me just give you a taste of two of them. And there are so many. Kiki, if you ever want to see something amazing, do children who are piano virtuosos. And you'll see four-year-olds, six-year-olds playing music that, you know, it makes you want to put your piano away.
I can imagine.
This brilliant monocular telescope is taking the world by storm. It lets you see everything from miles away.
This is a 10-year-old girl in Denmark. One of the most famous Led Zeppelin songs. Rock and roll. This little boy is 3 years old. Three. What stuns me about that, he's got this rhythm. He's got it within him. He's not watching the conductor. He feels the beat and he does not speed up or slow down the beat. That's amazing for young children. They have a natural tendency to not play consistent. And this kid is playing a very difficult, well-known symphonic piece and holding the beat. And I've listened to this multiple times. He makes a couple mistakes, but he's 3 years old. My goodness. So
I would do way more if I would even like study it for years.
You know, he comes out of the womb with this capability. That's just amazing, you know. So I mentioned earlier about neurology, and I'm going to give you a taste of the neurology right now, because there's a ton of information that has appeared in the last two decades as science has begun to catch up. We have new ways of now measuring brain activity and more in-depth techniques to assess the impact of certain brain stimulus. So there are now conclusions, scientific studies, multinational scientific studies, that talk about these six areas of positive effects on the brain of an adolescent child. Their ability to perceive, not just read, the ability to perceive, to understand intention, more than just the literal definition. It's not just play the note A flat at this particular measure. It's knowing that at that particular measure, that A flat is supposed to be very soft. And so they perceive the purpose of the music as they're playing the music. Their ability to increase their language and literacy skills. And this shows up in a variety of ways. First of all, a lot of music has terminology that is not in English. It's often in Latin. Sometimes it's in another language entirely. And so the vocabulary of children expands. They learn that allegro means slow and flowing. And they begin to apply the word allegro to other words that use it as a basis in the linguistic sense, like allegory. So children expand their knowledge of language, their vocabulary, et cetera. They certainly are playing with numbers, whether it's the time signature on a piece of music, whether it's understanding the beats, whether it's understanding when the conductor does 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. They're playing with numbers all the time. There's a constant building block approach to music. Children who play music progressively play harder music. They become bored with the simple stuff and they want to be challenged. There's also peer pressure that will take place when you have things like school bands or orchestras. Their ability to persevere when most children don't have the ability to hold the thought more than 3 or 4 seconds, children learn to be patient with themselves. They learn concentration. They learn to pay attention for prolonged periods of time. And when you get into performing ensembles, there is actually a benefit to the physical body. If you just consider wind instruments, if you just consider string instruments, there's some amazing coordination going on with body movements, hand positions, finger positions, and the relationship between what they're hearing in the way of a sound that's being produced by the instrument that they're playing. Now, I may have shared with you before, as a drummer, I got the opportunity to play a bass drum in my high school marching band in my senior year. And then I got to play other drums as well. While saxophone was my major instrument and I was playing guitar on the side, I got to do this little bit of things. Now, marching band in 1969 is very different than it is today. Let me just give you a taste, and this builds upon what you've already seen in tonight's presentations. But this is my old high school, my son Alex's and Justin's old high school marching band. 17 seconds. Now look what's in front. It's like all those marimbas. I'm going to stop this because I could talk about this incessantly, but I want you to just grasp what it is you just saw. So out on the field, there's a group of musicians carrying horns. They are playing music that they have memorized. There's no music in their hands. They have memorized this music. There are parts of the music that they're playing that require them to be soft or loud. There are parts of the music that require them to blend or stick out. And all that is occurring while they're moving. And they're moving to a memorized drill. They have learned the choreography like a dance team, and how each person has a place on the field, interacting and being spaced appropriately with other members of their band. Now, this is a high school. These adolescents are 15, 16, 17, 18. To teach students of that age this type of coordinated activity says volumes, not only about the teaching, but about the students. That quite literally, in 2 weeks, they learn an entire show. And 2 weeks later, they'll learn a different show. Different music, different drill, etc. And these guys in the front, what is called, referred to as the pit, they don't move, they're not out marching around on the field, but their music is absolutely intricate and coordinated with what everybody else is doing. Sometimes they are the music that the band on the field is silently marching to. They're not playing. And sometimes they're all playing simultaneously. But again, it's an amazing orchestration and coordination of activities. And I say it again, with teenagers. So, when I see something like this, I constantly remind myself, not only that I did this and look what I have done with my life, but there's such beautiful hope for the future of children. Okay. Now, I want to take this real quickly one step further and talk about another style of marching group for kids, adolescents. Only this one doesn't stop at high school. This actually goes to the age of 21. This is called a drum and bugle corps. And what you're going to see is an alumni drum and bugle corps. So most drum and bugle corps throughout the country, and there are hundreds and hundreds of them, and they have survived right through the pandemic. They rehearse the entire year to do one show. They learn their music, they learn their drill, and they constantly refine and improve that. Now, I marched in drum corps 1 year, and I went back and estimated the number of hours I spent in rehearsals. It was over 2,000. Over 2,000 hours in rehearsals for either music or drills, as well as the performances themselves. But there's a certain joy that comes from being in an elite class. This group we're about to see, this is the Santa Clara Vanguard from the San Francisco Bay Area.
From the planets. Oops. Following a...
This is a 50-year-old drum and bugle corps, and these are people that some of them go back to the 60s, marched in the 60s, and they're out here as adults getting to play. And I had a bunch of friends that were here. I didn't get to do this, but I had a bunch of friends. That guy right there is actually was the band director at San Jose State University.
Ladies and gentlemen, for you folks here in Wisconsin.
I just want to show you the ending. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's try that again.
Instructor Scott for fans.
There's one very special thing I want to find here. I may not find it. That's a drum and bugle corps. And the only reason I wanted to bring this out is because it's an extension of the rhythm and vibrations we've been talking about. And it introduces this entire aspect of the brain, and in particular, children's brains. Now, what you just saw in that last clip were a bunch of adults who, in some cases, 30, 40, 50 years later, are still playing their instruments at a very high level. They have a discipline and a skill that doesn't leave just because they turn 21 or 2. It stays with them forever. And that, I think, is in this last statement, what is learned. This is a clip directly out of the Drum Corps International Library. What is learned by being a member of Drum Corps? Teamwork, discipline, perseverance, determination, communication, listening, physical fitness, coordination, left brain and right brain concurrent exercising. So if you understand what goes on in the human brain, the left brain is very much functioning differently than the right brain. They work conjunctively with each other all the time, and they work independently from each other all the time. Now, I referenced earlier scientific studies that have been done. And the amount of brain activity when you see these drum and bugle corps and high school marching bands doing this type of activity, the amount of brain activity is at an extreme. The brain is being exercised in ways that it typically is not. And so the students get a benefit by that. It's like being an extreme athlete. You're not just able to run a mile, you're able to run a mile in under 5 minutes. You're not just able to play an instrument, you're able to play an instrument and do an entire choreographed show, perform to a standard of excellence, and you're playing at the height of your musicianship and making no bad notes. So it's truly an extreme element that takes place. Let me get my mouse back. Yes. So I promised you something. I'm going to take off my headphones and I will continue speaking, and I'm going to give you a bit of demonstration. So the first thing I want to demonstrate are two practice items for drummers. This is called a drum mat, and if you look at it three-dimensionally, you'll see it's got a raised center section. And it produces a dull sound. Now, why is that important? Well, if you have children who are learning how to drum at home, you don't want to be hearing the drums. Here's another drum practice thing. Again, much simpler, much quieter, and represents a real drum head. So when you have learned basic drumming techniques, you can do simple drum cadences, or you can do something a little bit more rhythmic. And you notice I've got different sounds being created by hitting the metal part and not just the skin part. Now that's on a representation of a drum. But now I want to take you to something that is far more representative of Mark's roots. So here we have your common pots and pans and utensils, plastic, wooden, metal. Oh, that doesn't work. You begin to play. And this is what I did with both of my boys at about 2 years old. I sat them down on the kitchen floor. I pulled out the pots and pans and knives and not knives, spoons and rubber mallets and anything else I could find. And I let them go at it. And so I had a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old making beautiful music for 5 minutes. Now, there's something else that a lot of people will do, and it's to play with glasses. So here I have 2 different size glasses. Don't know that I can show you, but you can listen. And the real technique is to have a whole set of glasses filled with different levels of water. And the water will generate different tones based on how much water is in the glass. And if you are scientific enough or just have a good ear, you can create an entire scale, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, with glasses of water and play songs. And yes, I've done this. Now, tonight was all about rhythm with a whole lot of creative approaches taken. But hopefully you now get a sense of the importance of the beat in whatever sound it might be, in whatever speed it might be, in whatever syncopated fashion with other sounds it might be, the importance of the beat. As a guitarist, Nora knows the song you're singing works if you are strumming or picking at a tempo. When Nora, recently you sang Smile? Yeah. Okay, and I loved it because it was this perfect pace. It had the perfect tempo. It was just like it was meant, just like it was recorded that way. That's what makes songs work, is the tempo. It's not just the song and the words, it's the tempo. It's the underlying beat. If the beat doesn't work, the song's not gonna work. So in future sessions, we're going to play more with vibrations, going to talk more about the impact of vibrations on the spirit world and in both incarnate and discarnate forms. I'm going to talk about more about the science of playing music, and in particular, wind instruments. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the brain. I'm going to get a little bit more into the neurology of the brain and show some of these studies and some of the images that are available on the internet. And of course, as many musical examples and live performances as I can do. Okay, I'm going to now get formal and ask Nora if you're available next Friday night.
I am.
I would love it if you could do Smile.
Oh, that's so sweet. Yes, of course.
Okay. There's a purpose behind wanting that song, of course.
Okay. Thanks, dear brother.
Okay. Any questions, any comments?
No questions. Just, I think it was very, very interesting. I didn't, like, every time when I would think about drums, my knowledge was so narrowed into like the drums that I know. Like, it's amazing. So thank you so much. It's really, and it was beautiful. I loved all the examples that you brought, specifically the first one that you had, like the music. If you can send me like what the music is, I really want to hear that. I found that very interesting. Like all the,
I will send
the history, it's amazing. Yes. So thank you, Mark. I appreciate that.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. It was good. I do love those drums. What did you call them? The Seth of drums or?
Timpani? The big kettle drums?
Yeah.
Timpani.
Timpani.
T-Y-M-P-A-N-I. Timpani.
Timpani. Thank you so much.
Interesting name.
So I really liked how you brought the science part of it. I think I shared with you all that I had just started playing about a year ago, actually, right? And about, was it like this week? I had a real busy week. And so I'm multitasking and I'm with a toothbrush in one hand and I'm pouring coffee with another. And I'm doing two things at the different things at the same time. And I was like, how is this happening? And I think you nailed it, because as you're practicing, you see that your hands and your coordination starts to improve. It totally reminded me of that.
So when I was wanting to be a real drummer, this student said to me, well, can you pat your head and rub your stomach? Can you pat your head?
I never do that.
Okay. We're now high. Change. Can you rub your head and pat your stomach? Okay.
Oh my God.
Because that is teaching you literally left brain, right brain symmetry. This is what drummers do. This is what pianists do. This is what guitarists do. Their left hands and their right hands are working independently. Now, a drummer on a drum kit takes that to a whole nother level, because he's got 2 feet as well. And he's not just drumming on drum heads, he's got cymbals and different kinds of cymbals to do different kinds of sounds. So a drummer's complexity goes way beyond rubbing your, you know, patting your head and rubbing your tummy, because they've got a brain that I do not understand. I can do 1 foot, but I cannot get 4 separate rhythms going on 2 hands and 3 feet. It's just not in my DNA.
That is very challenging with your feet. I tried it one time. I was like, no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's why when you see a 3-year-old or a 10-year-old doing this, you go, oh my gosh, that is astounding. And one other thing, the evolution of the musical instruments has contributed greatly. So you now have musical instruments that are designed to make it easier to do certain things. So for example, in a drum kit, the more advanced drummers, instead of having 2 bass drums, one for the left foot, one for the right foot, they will have a device that goes only on the right foot, but plays 2 mallets against the drum at the same time, or in a syncopation fashion. So the drummer is taught how to manipulate their feet as though they've got two sticks connected to their foot to give two different beats against the drum. And the most talented drummers of all, they're making the drum sounds incredibly fast, incredibly fast. You know, what dexterity they have in a physical sense is just astounding, just astounding. Anyway, obviously it's a passion of mine.
and it shows in what you present, Mark. It is very informative and very interesting. It's awesome. Thank you so much.
I will tell you, I have loved the spiritual downloads I receive every week, because tomorrow I'll start thinking about what am I going to do next Friday, and by Wednesday somebody will have told me what I'm doing on Friday. All right, who would like to take us home?
I'll do it.
Thank you, Regina.
Okay, join me in closing our eyes. As we give thanks for the lessons today about drumming, and give thanks to Mark for being a wonderful teacher and the patience of working with us, all of us new beginners. And we thank our Heavenly Father for allowing us this space and time. And we ask God to bless us, to allow us to take in this information and the ability to practice this information when we're ready. And with that, we ask you, Heavenly Father, to continue blessing us as we rested and at night. And we're so grateful to all the mentors for encouraging us to stay strong. And we ask you, Father, to bless the closing of our class tonight. In your name, so be it.
Thank you, Regina.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, everyone. Beautiful
night. Thank you very much, Mark.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mark. That was awesome.
Thank you.
And I see Dree is there.
Now we can drum away.
Yeah. I forgot to say that. You know, that finger tapping thing, that's annoying to some people. I don't care. I don't care.
Mark, I thought you were going to have us drum.
We're going to do that in a future session.
No, and I say that because I did this workshop and they actually brought drummers and they did a therapy with the drums, but we were doing it through Zoom and they had us do exercises. Oh. Very interesting.
Very cool.
That's cool.
I used to have a few for show drumming, big drums, like a conga. And I donated it to the high school. but I'm trying to remember, where did I buy that? I don't even remember, but I had this conga forever and I would play it for 10 seconds every year. That's about it. That just doesn't fit the Spiritist low material mindset, So I'm happy to be giving away my instruments. Okay, everyone.
All right.
Have a blessed evening.
Thank you.
See you all tomorrow.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.